हेलो फ्रेंड्स, हाउ आर यू? इफ यू कांट गो आउटसाइड, गो इनसाइड. परहैप्स यू माइट हैव कम अक्रॉस दिस कोटेशन इन द लास्ट फ्यू डेज. सिंस द पीरियड ऑफ लॉकडाउन, वी नो दैट वी कांट गो आउटसाइड. इफ वी गो स्टेप आउट, वी हैव द फियर ऑफ पुलिस पीपल हु आर ट्राइंग टू कीप अस सेफ. And they are doing it for our sake. So it's not possible to go outside. Then we can go inside and look into ourselves in this beautiful time where we have some rest for our daily routine. We can, I think, explore the hidden potentials within us. And maybe after the lockdown is over, we can come out with better prospects for ourselves. We will come more equipped. We will know what is there within us. We will know our potential. We will know our skills. And yes, truly this is the time to explore within our capacities. We have so many talents, so many skills, so many potentials hidden within us. But due to our routine schedule, we have been unable to explore them. Perhaps some of us may be music artists. Some of us may be artists, that is painters. Some of us may be dancers. So we have lots of potential within us, and this is the right time to once again go back to our skills and potentials and enjoy being ourselves. Wherein, if we do this, we can avoid the negative impact that is happening around us. We get many negative news in news channels today because of the deaths that are happening due to corona worldwide. So there is a lot of negative thing that is happening around us. But if we try to explore within ourselves, maybe we can find some happiness and keep away the tension of the corona outbreak. This is what I feel. So if we can't go outside, we will all try to go inside and search within ourselves. So, continuing from yesterday's class, I have already told you the plot that is taken from the original story of Mahabharata, and I also mentioned that there are possibilities of deviations because Mahabharata, Ramayana and other mythological tales don't come in a single authentic version. There are always additions and deletions in different versions. So, I have given you the background story of Abhijnana Shakuntala that is found in the Mahabharata. Now today we are going to study about the text particularly written by Kalidasa. Abhijnana Shakuntala is a highly romantic drama written by, of course, no need to mention him again and again, Kaviratna Kalidasa. It is the love story of Dushyanta and Shakuntala, and again I'll mention this once again that every dramatist makes use of certain techniques and tries to modify the story according to his times. So there are some modifications made by Kalidasa in the main story of the drama, and the exact date of or year of composition is not known. Still, the scholars of Sanskrit who have tried to study deeper into the dramatics of Kalidasa date it somewhere between 4th and 5th century. That was the period in which the scholars claim Kalidasa lived. And in fact, it is one of the most important works in the classic literature, and this is the first Indian drama to be translated into English. And this translation was done by Sir William Jones in 1789. That is the first translation of this drama into English. So, let us now come to the story, and then after looking at the story, we can explore the different aspects of this drama. So, this play is divided into 7 acts. And I'll just tell in brief what all happens in these 7 acts. The first act is when Dushyanta, the king, is going into the forest in search of a game which he is hunting, and by chance he happens to come into the hermitage of Kanva Rishi, and there he meets Shakuntala, who is spending her time in garden with her friends. So here it is what we call in the modern words, that is love at first sight, that happens between Shakuntala and Dushyanta. Both of them fall in love with each other. So this happens in act 1. Then in act 2, there is a conversation between King and Vidushaka, and perhaps this is an addition given by Kalidasa in this drama. So the role of Vidushaka does not come to a greater extent in the original story, but to add fun to the drama or to add some more entertainment to the story of the drama, there is this role of Vidushaka, who is very friendly with the king, and both of them share light moments. And during this conversation, King expresses his feelings of love to Shakuntala. He expresses them in front of Vidushaka. So this conversation, a very nice conversation, happens between King and Vidushaka, and Vidushika is like a comical character. This is Kalidasa's contribution to the story. And then the third act is the continuation of King's story in the hermitage of Kanva. He is there in the ashram of Kanva, and both are shown as lovesick. On one side, Dushyanta keeps thinking about Shakuntala when he is doing the duties for the sake of ascetics in the ashram in order to protect them. And on the other side, whenever Shakuntala is spending her time with her friends, she is remembering Dushyanta. So both are shown as lovesick people. And then after some time, there is confession of love for each other. Both of them confess love for each other, and they undergo secret marriage, that is called as Gandharva Vivaha. Now this Gandharva Vivaha is not openly shown in the drama. It is implied. So there is no episode or a dialogue that says that they are going to marry now or they will be marrying soon. But later it is implied through the plot of the drama, we come to know that they have already married in secret, and that was a Gandharva marriage in absence of Kanva Maharshi. And after that, immediately after the secret marriage, so the king has been called to the capital for his duty, and this starts the separation. So this is the turning point of the drama, where some troubles start for both hero and the heroine. And then we go into act number 4, where this is full of grief. Now this act is not a happy one, because in this act we see that both the king as well as his lover, or his wife now, Shakuntala, are in grief because of a curse. In fact, here king is not shown to be in grief, because the king has already gone to the capital. He is doing his duties as a king in Hastinapur, and he has totally forgotten about Shakuntala. So in this act, we come to see the reason of Shakuntala's grief, the curse given by Rishi Durvasa when she was unable to give him hospitality. So this happens in act number 4, and immediately Kanva comes from his penance. He comes back to ashram after a few days, and he understands with his divine knowledge, he understands that Shakuntala is married to Dushyanta in secret, and he feels extremely happy that she has married a right kind of a man. So he arranges for Shakuntala's departure to her husband's house. So act number 4 ends with the departure of Shakuntala from her hermitage, and how she is emotionally attached to all the pet animals and the trees that she has nurtured right from her childhood in the hermitage, how she feels some sort of a bond with those trees, and how she is extremely emotional. She is sad to leave, to take leave of these trees and the garden. All this is shown in act number 4 towards the end. In act number 5, we can see that the curse is in action. It is in full swing now. Now, Shakuntala along with some of the ascetics who have accompanied Shakuntala, they have escorted Shakuntala to the court of King Dushyanta. They all arrive in the court of Dushyanta and the king fails to recognize this woman who is veiled. And the veil is taken off and the ascetics try to tell him that this is the same woman whom he had married in the forest, but the king is unable to unrecognize Shakuntala because of the curse which is now in action, the curse given by Durvasa Rishi, that the king, that the man about whom she was thinking will forget her. So the same thing has happened now, and king, in fact, he does not keep quiet there. He accuses Shakuntala, and Shakuntala is taken away. She suddenly disappears. So this is one supernatural element added in Kalidasa, in the drama by Kalidasa, to show that she was a celestial woman. So Shakuntala is taken away in the form of light by Menaka to the heavenly abode, and now king's regret starts. Now king is bewildered by this incident. So this act ends in the confusion of the king as to what was his relation to the lady who had come to his court and who claimed that she was pregnant with his child. In act number 6, this is the recovery from the pain. This act symbolizes recovery from the curse. So what happens here? Already now in act number 5, Shakuntala has disappeared to the heavenly abode with the help of Menaka, and in act 6, she is not there at all. In act 6, it is the court scene wherein the fisherman is caught by the police, and in fact, this is also an addition, a kind of a twist given by Kalidasa in this tale. In the original story, we don't have the role of police here. In the original story, which I mentioned yesterday, the fisherman cuts open the stomach of a fish and he suddenly gets the ring, recognizes the ring that it is the king's ring. He goes to the court and surrenders it himself. But now in this play, to show how the king was efficient leader, to show how he had managed to keep the police system effective in the town, this episode is introduced wherein the fisherman is caught by the police and he is brought to the court of the king. This here, the fisherman produces the ring to the king and says that he had found it in the stomach of a fish. The police are unable to believe that. The king orders the police to go and verify the facts told by fisherman, and they go and find out that whatever fisherman told was all right. So fisherman is duly respected, honored and given gifts by the king because he had brought back his ring. And immediately after looking at this ring, there is sudden remembrance of Shakuntala to Dushyanta, and now king is totally sad because he knows what he has done to the lady who had come to his court, who was none other than his own wife. So he goes into a mood of lamentation and sorrow. Now there is also a secret thing that is happening in act 6. There was a doubt in the mind of Menaka, the celestial mother of Shakuntala, that the king might forget everything about Shakuntala. But in fact, king had not forgotten. When he got the ring, he suddenly remembers everything that had happened in Kanva's hermitage, and now he is really sad. So to keep a spy on the actions and the nature and the behavior of Dushyanta, celestial nymph Menaka has appointed her friend Sanumati to keep an eye on the activities of the king and report about his activities. So these all things happen in act number 6, and in act 7, that is the climax of happiness, wherein the, and here in act number 7, although Dushyanta and Shakuntala reunite as lovers, as husband and wife, so their reunion is brought about through some divine interference. And this is a significant event in the drama. Indra sends his charioteer and his chariot. The charioteer's name is Matali. Matali comes from the heavenly abode to meet Dushyanta and says that Indra is in need of Dushyanta's help to fight some demons. So Dushyanta has to go to Indra to fight a war for him, and successfully returns from the war having killed the demons. And Indra is extremely pleased with the work, with the deeds of Dushyanta as a great warrior, and he is blessed by Lord Indra. When they are coming down, when they are coming down to earth, descending on the earth, they see, they means here Dushyanta and the charioteer Matri. So both of them see that there is a nice hermitage, and they identify that this hermitage is belongs to Rishi Maricha, and they go there to seek his blessings. And it is here in the hermitage of Maricha, Rishi Maricha, that the reunion of lovers take place. So it is very interestingly shown in act number 7, and they live happily ever after with their son Bharata. So this is, I just told you in brief about the 7 acts and how the story is divided into these 7 acts of the drama. Of course, there are some more details I would like to discuss as we go on in the detailed analysis of the plot. So we need to understand, so this is the story that has been modified a little somewhere here and there in every act by Kalidasa, and as a tradition of dramatic techniques, Kalidasa had to follow certain principles. Now Indian dramas always began with something called Nandi, or we call it prelude in English. It is nothing but an invocation to God. There is a character, always this is an important character in every drama, may it be an ancient Indian drama or modern Indian drama, there has been always a character called Sutradhara, and his role is, he is in English, his name is, his character is translated as actor narrator or actor manager. So what is his role? His role is to narrate the story or the background story of the action that will be taking place on the stage henceforth. So he is like the link between the story and the audience. He keeps on narrating in between, and also not just narrating, he keeps on interpreting the story. Somewhere the action cannot tell the whole story, wherever the story is missing, then the sutradhara or the actor manager will cover up that part through his narration. So he also plays an important role in Indian dramas. In fact, he is the one who introduces the story and who introduces the characters onto the stage in the beginning of the drama. So the dramas always begin with Nandi Pada, which is called as benediction or invocation to God, because it is a tradition in India to salute a god before they begin any good work. So usually it is the Lord Ganpati, whom they invoke in the Nandi or the benediction song, and once they salute this god, they start narrating the story. So here in this drama there is a prelude, and this is also very important in this play, because here in this prelude we can see the setting of the whole drama told in the prelude by Sutradhara and his heroine. They call her Nati. So Sutradhara and his companion actress both come onto the stage in the beginning, and see, this has nothing to do with the story of Mahabharata. Story of Dushyanta and Shakuntala in the Mahabharata. This is an addition. This is an element which has been included for the sake of dramatization. There are multiple purposes behind behind keeping this part in the beginning. You see, whenever drama is being staged, we usually expect audience to come. Sometimes, if we begin the story directly, some audience who might be delayed for the show may miss out the main story. So in order to avoid this problem, in order to make the audience important, prelude or nandi is introduced in the play, so that even if the audience come late to the show, they should not miss the main plot of the novel, which they can understand by action. So this is one important reason why prelude is always kept in the beginning of the drama. Then the second important reason is that in prelude, sometimes the background story is told. Now, for example, we have a concept called in medias res. It is a Latin term and it has been used often in the criticism of dramas and novels. In medias res means in the middle of the things. So whichever novel or drama you take, the story does not happen right from the beginning. It is very rarely seen in that way. So what happens usually, whenever the novelist begins his novel or a dramatist begins his drama, there is a main action going on and the reasons are not told in the initial stage. The background story is told somewhere later in the novel or drama. So the things happen right from in the middle of the things the novel starts. So it is very natural way of any kind of a narration, because you see, it is most common way that we approach people. We meet a lot of people around us every day, and do we know their whole story right from the beginning? No, quite impossible, right? So we meet them at certain point of their life and certain point of our life, where already some part of their life has been spent and we don't know about their past, right? Whenever I meet a friend, I don't know about his past. I right now, what is he doing? I know that part only. And maybe the future I will know because of my company with him. But I don't know about the past. So to know that, what I have to do is I have to make good friendship with this newly made friend. And after some days, he will start narrating me the past story. So it is very natural way of narrating anything. So this has always been given importance as a technique of drama and narration. So the things of any story start from the middle of somewhere, in the middle of somewhere. Later, the background story is told. Or rather, we come to know the background story through one or the other character in the drama or in the novel. So this usually happens in case of novels, but in the dramas also the main action begins in medias res, that is in the middle of the things. And in order to make us aware of the background story, Sutradhara takes this important work in his hand. So Sutradhara also tells us the background story. For example, who is Dushyanta? Who is Shakuntala? We don't know. We know only them as the hero and heroine of the play, but we want to know their background. So this man, Sutradhara, and his companion actress inform us who Dushyanta is, that he is the king of Hastinapur, that he is the ancestor of Kuru dynasty, and he was an able king. Why did he come to the forest in which the action is going to take place now? What animal he was chasing? So all these details are told by the actor manager, the Sutradhara, and his companion actress in the prelude. So prelude is important for this second reason. Now there is One more reason why prelude is important. The third reason is that sometimes, I don't say that this is always possible. If a drama company is rich, they can arrange for all the paintings and the stage decoration material through which they can create a scene, right? But some drama companies are amateur. They include amateur artists and they are doing it just for the sake of their hobby. So they don't have all these accessories or props. The proper word is props required for the drama, like the stage setting, the huge curtains that are required behind the stage, what kind of design or painting should be there at the backdrop. So they don't have, some of the drama companies don't have these kind of things with them, which they can use as props. But they have the interest of playing the drama or acting out the drama. So what they can do is, in order to fill that gap, wherein you can't create the scene at the background, this prelude helps us in creating the scene also. So this is third important reason why prelude is important in a drama, or it is included in the technique of dramaturgy. So here we can see that Sutradhara introduces, he invokes Lord Ganesha and starts the play, and he tells the story of Dushyanta and Shakuntala in brief about their background, who is Kanva and all, and his companion actress, she gives us the stage setting. So she tells how is the mood of the nature right now, because the king has entered into the forest. Now she has to describe the forest scene. So how are the trees? How is the atmosphere? How is the weather? So she goes on describing the natural elements that were required to create the scene, because now the king has entered the hermitage of Rishi Kanva. So she explains how the season was very beautiful because it was the spring season, the Vasanta Rutu, which is known as the most beautiful season in India, and it is the symbol of romance. So even the it is a sign that the play will be a romantic play because it is set in the time of Vasanta Rutu. So she describes about different beautiful birds and the trees which are blossomed with flowers, colorful flowers, fragrant flowers. So she gives the description of beauty of nature in this springtime when this story takes place. So with this introduction to the scenery, she is giving us a stage background, sort of stage background. So now with all these descriptions, we know where the drama is taking place and what is the kind of surrounding in which the drama is taking place. When these details are told, even if the background designs or curtains are not there, we can manage to understand the story. So this is the importance of prelude in the play, and it is also called as prologue. So it is always in the beginning of the play. One thing I told you, it is important so that main action is not missed by the audience, who may be finding it difficult to come on time sometimes. And also it is the way of asking for God's grace for this performance. So it is invocation. And the third reason is it helps in creating the setting required for the story that will take place in the form of action. So this is about the prelude. And we have to remember that in this particular prelude of Abhijnana Shakuntala, in the beginning there is benediction of Lord Ganesha, the Sutradhara prays for the grace of lords, and then it is the description of spring season. Before that, Dushyanta and Shakuntala, Kanva Rishi, all of them are introduced in the beginning by Sutradhara. Then the actress who is accompanying Sutradhara sets the stage, or she shows in what kind of surroundings the story is going to take place with her descriptions of nature in the spring season, that is the Vasanta Samaya, which is very symbolic of romantic experiences in our Indian mythologies as well as Indian ethos. So this is all about prelude, after which the action is going to take place, which we will be discussing in our next lecture. So if you have any questions, you can ask them in comments, and in the next class we will look into the different acts and how this story proceeds. Thank you so much.